And we are live, baby. All right. Man, I'm excited today. I got my man, Mr. Steven Rosado. This is Mike Wall. I'm back with another episode of the Agent Revolution podcast where we deconstruct some of the biggest challenges facing today's real estate agent so they can build a sustainable, profitable, and most of all, fulfilling real estate business. Like I said, I'm super excited talking to my man, Steven Rosado, about the science behind becoming a better prospector and using it to scale a real estate business. As always, I'll be posting this episode over at my on my website, at explodingwealth.com when we're done. So head on over there for the replay. And without further ado, let's get started. Welcome to the show, Steven.
Thank you for having me, man. Really appreciate it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, man. So why don't we just to start the show, I usually get started just by getting a quick background on you, man. Tell me how you got into real estate, why you got into real estate, and kind of what you're doing now.
Cool. So I've always been in sales. So I grew up in a family that my father owns car dealerships out in Pennsylvania. Okay. So I was a car salesman at one point in time.
Sure.
So it was kind of like the natural progression. I found myself, interestingly enough, better in the service department of the dealership, which interesting, I still use some of the mentality from the service department rather than the sales department. Because at the end of the day, and I tell people this over and over again, real estate it's a service industry.
Sure.
You know, so the better service you provide, the more you just become financially free. And that's where, you know, referrals just kind of come out of the woodwork. Yeah. So I worked in sales, I worked in the service department. And then I worked in insurance. So I was selling insurance for Liberty Mutual. I was transferring out to New York. And it wasn't really working out because the product that I was selling, they transferred me to a section of the Bronx to where it just, you know, wasn't the product for that area. Yeah. And I was looking for something else. So the woman that had rented me my apartment called me and was like, hey, you know what? I saw your resume when you were, you know, you were renting your apartment, and I think you would be awesome in real estate. So she brought me on. I worked in the same agency as Brett Sikora and Dave DeVoe. Mm-hmm. We were working together there for a while. We had a great time at a small agency, mom and pop type. Then we moved on to Dave left. He went to Liberty. He started crushing it over there. Brett went and joined his team, and then they called me and they were like, hey, man, you know, we think you'd be great. And I was his buyer's agent, and it was about 7.5 years ago.
Yeah. That's awesome, man. And by the way, both Brett and Dave have been on the show. They are avid prospectors as well, and certainly delivered some value. So you've got some big footsteps to follow in, but I know, I know you will impress, my friend. I know you will impress. You know, today's topic is something that's kind of near and dear to my heart. I mean, I built my business on the phones, calling expireds. And so I'm always excited to kind of talk to other people that built their business that way. Although there's a piece of me, I think, that admires and maybe is a bit jealous of the folks that, you know, go on referral appointments all day, every day. I mean, there's a piece of me that just feels a lot safer knowing that I can create my own business whenever I want to, and I'm not always waiting on a phone call from someone that knows me from the past, right?
That's true, man. Yeah, it's all about predictability, you know.
Predictability and scale, for sure, man. So, you know, let's dig right in. Tell me a little bit about like your business today. Like, what impact or what role do the phones play in your business today?
I mean, everything is really phone based for me. And there's times I'm just like everybody else to where, you know, I'll be hesitant to get on the phone sometimes. You know, it's just a natural human trait. But you know, you've talked about this on your podcast or your live cast before about mindset. So on a daily ritual, mindset is key. That's how I start off my day. And that's how I get back on track with prospecting. Yeah. So, you know, in terms of prospecting, and you may have some views on this too, I think prospecting's changed a little bit. The basics are obviously the same, but I think connecting with people has changed a little bit. So I have incorporated some video follow-up and stuff like that. But as it pertains to just picking up the phone, there's no higher return on your investment.
Yeah. So when you say connecting with people, define that. What do you mean by that?
Well, we're in an area, we're in a market that is highly saturated with real estate agents. It's very, very competitive. So the rate of return for expireds has been much lower than it was when I first started prospecting.
Okay.
You know, in 2013 to 15, there wasn't too many agents that were excited, you know, to get on the phone and list properties because everything was expiring before that.
Right, right.
You know? So being somewhat fresh in that market, being able to pick up the phone and you know, maybe only two agents had called them before.
Yeah.
Versus, you know, 15 to 20, the approach had to change a little bit.
Yeah. So talk to me about how that, what did that change look like for you?
Well, now I'm consistently reminding myself of why I'm making that phone call. Let's talk about expires because I think expires is one that people focus on.
Yeah.
So I have to consistently remind myself why I'm doing it. And you know, meaning what's the purpose behind the call? You know, before it was more about just hitting the numbers, you know, more about just hitting your contacts, making the call. But now it's more about the reason behind why I'm making the call and having the understanding that the person on the other line is likely getting a lot of calls and they're likely upset because they signed a contract with a real estate agent, a professional that didn't sell their home.
We use that word loosely, by the way, because the word professional can be used very loosely with some real estate agents for sure.
Yeah. And listen, and once you put it in those terms, right? So when you have that realization that, you know, you put yourself in their shoes and you're just like, listen, they just hired a real estate agent, somebody in their mind that was a professional. They signed a contract with them and they didn't get the job done. So now, you know, you're an agent amongst probably 10 to 15 other agents calling them, trying to get them to list their property again. And, you know, in their mind, we're all the same.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. It's about how do you differentiate yourself from that crowd immediately and, you know, level with them. So,
yeah, I always found, I mean, one little secret I like to give is if you understand the statistics, that 70% of sellers do business with the first agent they talk to after mm-hmm. their listing expires.
Yeah.
And so one of the things I used to do, and granted, you cannot use a dialer before 8 a.m. I think that's a federal law, but you can peck dial people before 8 a.m. And so I would always make it to the phones around 7:40 or 7:45, and yeah. I would pick out like the freshest expireds I could pick that I knew I would want to. I knew I would want an opportunity to list their property, and I would call those first because mm-hmm. I knew, Stephen, that no one else had the balls to call before 8 o'clock, right?
Yeah.
And I always had great conversations. My conversations were no different than if I called at 8 o'clock. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And so, I'm just playing the odds. You know what I mean? I know if 70% of people they list with the first agent they talk to after their listing expires, then I need to be first, right? Even if I'm not the best, I need to be yeah. first. At least I'm going to give myself a shot.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, like for you, the one thing I want to talk about, because we just briefly touched on this, and I love getting into conversations about mindset, man.
Yeah.
Because, you know, people always want to blame skill set. It's an easy place to go. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. But the reality of it is we all know what to say. We all know what to do. Because if your mom's house expired, what would you say to her? You already know what to say, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so we just, there's a mindset problem. There's a disconnect. Everybody knows they need to be making phone calls in this business if they want to have success, yet they don't do it. They just don't do it. And so I want to know, I love getting, it's a different answer for everybody, but I want to know from you, man, what is the disconnect? Why don't people make the calls?
I think you put up, and you said this on one of your past casts, was why power outlasts willpower, you know? And I thought that was really awesome because at the end of the day, I think a lot of people don't really know what their why is, you know? So they can't push past that objection. It's fear of objection or rejection is mainly one of the reasons why they don't get on the phone. And it's hard to push yourself past that if you don't have that why.
Yeah.
So, and I myself, and probably you, and I think everybody that's been successful has to keep on continuing to revisit that why, to make sure that, you know, it excites them and they're willing to do what others are not willing to do. at the end of the day, I think once you know, we know this is a numbers game. You just pointed that out. You know, the first one has the best chance.
Yeah.
You're playing those odds. So it's a matter of doing that in volume. So how do you push yourself to do that? And mindset is all about the why.
Yeah. Yep. I couldn't agree more, man. And so like it really, I get passionate about that because I mean, one of the things that I enjoy doing most, I think now, is I love helping agents. Like I love getting involved with agents who want to learn, who want to grow, who actually want to build a business. Yeah. And so when I look and I saw these statistics last week, man, and it just blew my mind, man. There we have like 4,700 agents in our local MLS.
Yeah.
And of those 4,700, only 1,688 people got a paycheck last month.
Jesus.
So and we know it's probably like 15 of those closings were ours. And so we know we know that 10% of the agents do 90% of the business. So we know that number's even worse than what it looked like.
Yeah.
So where I get really passionate, man, is like, these people are not, there's a lot of good agents in there and they're just not getting the guidance, the direction that they need. And so yeah. Part of the reason why I do this show, man, is to get in front of people like you who seek knowledge, who seek to get better, but also take action so that this show might get in front of somebody else to help them take action, man. Because here's what I believe. I believe there are three kinds of agents. There's agents that take action, that they're always seeking growth and seeking to get better and then taking action. And then there's and this is the most common kind of agent, I think, right here. Or maybe I think the most common kind of agent is they want to get better. They're growth minded, but there's some disconnect between, you know, knowing what to do and then taking action. Yeah. But if you give them the proper guidance, in other words, if you water that seed, they will go. They will take action. And then there's the third kind of agent who, no matter what you teach them, they'll never do anything. You know what I mean? And they don't deserve your time, and they shouldn't be in the business anyway. They should go find, you know, what they're passionate about. But so that middle third is like, those are the people I want to personally get in front of because I think I can truly have an impact on their business. And we have those agents on our team. We've seen them come and go here. And, you know, usually they're better because they have been in front of us because we can teach them how to scale a business. Is that kind of what you see in your market? Do you feel like it's pretty much the same thing?
Yeah. And I think too, and I think Tom Ferry talks about this too, is you have a lot of the ones that you see that are not doing deals kind of got into the industry thinking it was going to be like a hobby type of thing.
Yeah.
And that's not there anymore, you know? You have to look at this as a business and really have an understanding of, you know, what your ratios are in terms of what it costs to do business, how to stay profitable. Because I see a lot of people that, you know, they're buying business and it's not profitable for them.
Yeah.
But, you know, as it pertains to the ones that you're saying in the middle, that, you know, they have a talent, they have ability. I think that really goes to what we're talking about. If their mindset isn't in the right place, if it's just slightly off, they're never going to do the things they know they should be doing.
Right.
When I'm coaching people, it's the third question I ask them is, you know, I start off with what's working for you. Then I go to what's not working for you. And then it's what's one thing you know you should be doing, but you don't do it. And why are you not doing it? You know?
Yeah.
And it's usually similar answers, you know, like they're like, I know I should be prospecting, right?
Yeah. Or,
you know, I know I should be hitting my COI. And then the question is, why are you not doing it? And they're just like, I don't know. But it goes back to the why.
Doesn't it always go back there? And so like for you, when you're having those conversations, how are you telling people to get in touch with that why? Like, how are you telling them to connect to that? Because if they know their why and they're still not, you know, taking action in their business, how are you getting them to get in touch with their why? Or is it maybe that they think what their why is isn't truly their why?
That's a good point too. Sometimes it's not as clear. Like sometimes people will fall into the what should my why be based off of what, you know, social media is telling me. But what really makes you excited? Like I can tell you, I can show you, I can tell you my why is strong. I know exactly what it is. Like I even made myself a personal website, gorosado.com. And one of the first things on there is goals. And I mapped out in 2 years, I'll be in Disney World with my family. We know exactly where we're going. In 8 years, we're going to Maui. And we mapped out that entire trip. I know exactly what it looks like. Yeah. It's crystal clear, you know, because there's going to be times, and you know this every day, like it's a mental roller coaster. So you have to go back to like, what am I excited about? And as soon as you do that, I mean, you just go back and you're excited and people can feel that.
Yeah. Yep. And it's funny because, you know, I love that you're a visual guy, man. And we know that most successful people, right, they do create that visual, that vision board that they can come in and look at every day. You know, they actually write down their goals. It's the first step to making them become tangible. And I think that really ties into, you know, into making your why something that creates emotion.
Yeah.
Because we know emotion creates action. And so if maybe you think you know what your why is and you're not dialed in each and every day, in other words, you know what you're supposed to do and you're just not doing it, then your why is probably truly not your why.
Yeah.
And you know, the funny thing is like, I think like we think that, and this may be a little bit of a controversial statement, but I think pain is a good thing. And I don't want you to think of pain in the sense of, hey, I want to hurt people. But what I mean is most people never change until they get to the point of feeling some pain. You know what I mean? Pain usually creates massive change because people want to run from pain. They don't want to feel pain. They don't want to be around it. And people will do more to avoid pain than they will to gain pleasure.
Isn't it sad? I'm one of those pain people too.
Yeah.
But you're right. It, Tony Robbins talks about it. You know, you're either drawn away from pain or towards pleasure.
So and the funny thing is like we always like that the heavier conversations for me are always on mindset because like the skill set part of making phone calls is it to me it's just easy, right? It's second nature. And I know, you know, that scares a lot of people, but the reality of it is most of your experience is gonna come from your phone calls anyway. In other words, all of your objection handling, it comes from experience. It comes from making the phone calls over and over and over again. And if you can get your mindset right, if you can get into a mindset where the no's just run off your back, you know, then you will, you can create some momentum and some success in this industry. And so getting that mindset piece right, the reason why I'm spending a little bit more time on the mindset piece is because it is the most critical. I think if you can get that right, then the rest of it really is pretty easy. Wouldn't you agree?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's simple. It's very simple. We keep going back to the fact that it's a numbers game.
Yeah.
And the only reason why it's not simple is because, you know, we'll psych ourselves out. And that's basically what it is, you know. So it's that battle of psyching yourself back in when you psych yourself out. And as long as you continue to win that battle, this is an amazing business. Yeah. You can win every single day.
Agreed, man. So let's start off with, let's talk about who to call, like what's working in your business today. I mean, we know like there's internet leads, there's FSBOs, expireds, there's neighborhood prospecting. What's really working for you right now?
So what's that?
There's sphere of influence.
Yeah, I mean, my sphere is actually working really well for me right now. But it's one that I always kind of touch on, and it's like sometimes it's hot, sometimes it's not.
Yeah.
So one shift that I made in my business almost 2 years ago is I started calling absentee owners, which I don't know if you guys, do you guys hit absentee owners?
We did. I have an investment business as well. We send out about 25,000 mail pieces. So we also have a guy that calls our absentee owners as well.
Got it. So absentee owners was a shift that I made. I felt like like I was telling you before, the expired business was starting to drop off a little bit. I saw less and less actually even relisting. So, but there's still the same volume of transactions happening. Yeah. So I think this is all a game of figuring out, you know, where's the cheese at right now, you know? So when expireds aren't really hitting that well, I'll move on to absentee owners. But I never stop my just listed, just solds. That's, in my opinion, the best rate of return overall in the long run.
Yeah.
That's where I built up my longest my best string of business over time. And I've gone as far as one of my Mike Ferry coaches taught me this. He was like, Steve, I hear you're having a hard time with expireds. What if those people got a call from somebody that just sold a property near them? It's like, okay, where are you going with this? He's like, take that same expired list and just use a just sold property you just sold and see what happens. The same people that were hanging up were just like, oh, what did that property sell for? How quick did you sell that? Right. So it's an approach thing sometimes too. Yeah. So you have to be open to changing your approach. I switched over to absentee owners. And then just listed just solds were really good. And now I'm actually going back to expireds.
Yeah. And one thing I want to piggyback on top of what you just said is, can't you approach a call like that a little bit more confidently?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Right? And the consumer can hear that, you know, hey, we just sold a house at 123 Main Street. It's six houses down from you. We sold it for, 98.6% of list price. It sold in, 24 days. Right. I mean, that you can call with some confidence, and that I think the consumer can hear that. And so definitely, I think that's a nugget, man. So that's a nugget for people who are calling the expireds now. And, the funny thing is, like, you're the first. I mean, I know guys call just listed and just solds, but I think that's really an untapped market. I don't think a lot of people are doing that, and I think they're probably missing out.
They mentally psych themselves out. It is a cold call unless you truly understand the script.
Yeah.
Right? So that's important, is understanding the questions in the script, rather than just reading through it.
Yeah.
It's when same coach, my Mike Ferry coach, his name was John Joseph. The guy was amazing. But that's what he did with me. He made me read the script line by line. And then he would stop me and say, why'd you ask that question? And I was I would take a guess, I didn't really know why I was asking the questions, but when I had an understanding of why I'm asking, where are you planning on moving next? It's not just to get to the next question. It's to find out, is there a level of motivation? Yeah. And how can you genuinely help these people achieve that goal?
Right. So with just listeds and just sold, and granted, we can talk about this for each category, but what is the approach to a just listed, just sold call?
Just listed, just sold approach. I do more with a just sold.
Okay.
The just listeds, I really do an open house invite.
Okay.
That's really the name of the game there is it's a very easy way to invite somebody to, and we throw mega open houses. So it's like inviting somebody to a party,
sure.
Not many people get pissed off about that.
Right.
So that I do that. And then I follow up with a just sold. So it's genuine. It's usually the third time they've heard my name.
Okay.
So they get the invite, they get the mailer, then I call them with a just sold. And it's very off the cuff. So it's very like, hey, it's Steve Rosado again. Give me a shout out. I don't know if you made it to the open house. I sent you the invite. But the property at 47 Mallard, we sold that in less than 7 days. And, I'm not just making this up, but, when we sell a home that fast, we'll usually sell a couple more right away in that same area. So just wanted to see, when are you moving?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's it.
So you're trying to, and by doing that, you're creating credibility, you're influencing them, and then you're trying to create a little urgency as well there at the end of the call, right?
Yeah, yeah, and it's a friendly, like I have like a more of an amiable type of personality, so I roll with that. I'm not a driver, so I don't pretend to be one. So for me, it works well when it's kind of off the cuff. I assume they got the mailer. I assume that I spoke to them before, regarding the open house.
Right.
So it's like a friendly, like, hey, we already know each other type of thing.
Yeah. And like, to me, the important nuances of prospecting, there's so much to like a call intro. Like, I'll give you a quick example. Like I probably get 30, 40 robocalls a day, literally.
I know.
And so I'm constantly blocking numbers. But I'm also listening for, who are the real professionals here? And one thing I know is like people are making a judgment about you in the first 3 seconds, the first couple words out of your mouth to determine, is this somebody I want to talk to, right?
Yeah.
So I'll tell you, the minute I hear, hi, is this Mr. Wall? I'm done. That's it. I'm done.
Hey, what's up, Mike? Isn't that better?
Right, hey, right. Because, hey, let me ask you this, Stephen. Which one of your friends calls you and says, hey, is this Mr. Rosado? Which one of your friends calls and says that?
That's a great point, man.
None.
That's a really good
point. Zero of your friends have ever called and said, hey, is this Mr. Rosado? Or Mr. Rosado, is that you?
Yeah.
Right? And then the second thing, the second biggest mistake, well, first of all, you always call somebody by their first name, right? Mike, is that you? Yeah, right? And so immediately, right, you broke down the first barrier. This guy might not be a teleprospector, right? He could be a friend. He called me by my first name, right? Mm-hmm. Secondly, I'm never throwing out the, hey, how you doing today? Right? Like, who gives a shit? Like, what? Why would anybody call? Like, when a teleprospector calls and says, hey, how you doing today? It's like, do you authentically think that they care how I'm doing?
Exactly.
They don't. That's the reality, is they don't. They really don't. And so, like, I'm saying, hey, you know, on an expired call, hey, hey, Bob? Yeah, this is Bob. Hey, just real quick. I was looking in the MLS, and I noticed that your home looks like it popped off the market. Is that correct, or did you sell the property? Well, it fell off the market last night. Right? And notice at this point, I haven't even introduced myself as a real estate agent, right?
Yeah.
Like, I'm just trying to have a conversation. And really what I'm trying to do is you know as well as I do, it's all about building rapport in that first 30 seconds, man.
Absolutely. Right?
And so it's what you say is so important. Your tonality is so important because people – they don't have the other visual cues that body language gives, you're limited. I'm reading an incredible book right now, Stephen, and I don't know if you've read it yet. It's called Never Split the Difference by Chris Voss.
Oh, I bet you know what? Somebody had told me about that. Didn't the writer of that, was he an MIT guy?
He was an FBI guy. He was the head negotiator for the FBI for 25 years. Chris Voss, right. He's all over the place right now. The guy's incredible, man.
I got to read that, man. Yeah. I read the background on that book, and it's incredible.
Yeah, actually doing a book club on that book right now with our team. But the guy is just unbelievable, man. And I'll tell you one of the biggest takeaways from that book so far, and I think that it will help everybody that listens to this, is really getting into empathy with the person on the other side of the phone. Quit thinking about you and start thinking more about their current situation. And if we're talking about expireds, what do we know about an expired? They may have been on the market for 3 months or 6 months. That, you know, they went back and forth with the realtor on phone calls, on show, getting the property ready, getting it cleaned up, getting excited every single time, and then no contract, no sale, right? And then they're back at square one after 6 months, right? And so what kind of approach are you taking with that person?
Well, that's why it's purpose-based, you know, that's why the mindset is I have to constantly remember what the purpose is behind the phone call. It's to help these people get their home sold that it didn't sell the first time around.
Yeah.
And to put myself in their shoes,
exactly,
100% of the time, the entire conversation. And when you do that, you know, when they feel it, they feel like they're talking to somebody that is on their team. They know that I care. I'm looking at it through their eyes, and it allows them to open up. And when we have that candid, open conversation, then I can work for them better. You know, if they're really telling me what their goals are, and I'm feeling the goals with them, you know, and I'm feeling them, you know, getting closer to their family or whatever they want to be. And I'm able to help them put a strategy together. And it may be a year down the line too, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like if they're like, you know, next year will work better, I 100% roll with that. I'm not going to convince them to, you know, I think sometimes people try to motivate unmotivated people when they're just not motivated right now.
Yeah. I made far more in my follow-ups than I've ever made on an initial phone call. I mean, the initial phone call, obviously, your purpose is one thing, is if you can't set an appointment, is that you're identifying the buying or selling cycle and then following up appropriately.
That's the name of the game. I mean, once again, we talk about it being a numbers game, obviously for context, but It's nothing without follow
up. Yeah. Yep. And like, so for the expired, man, you're always meeting them where they're at. One of my favorite lines for expireds was always, hey, you know, based on the photographs and location, this seems like something that would have sold. What happened? Right? It's like, what happened? I'm on your side. What happened? The photos are beautiful. You're in a great location. It didn't sell, you know, and really getting in there with them, man. I love it. And you know, and so like every conversation's different, and that's why it's so important to know your audience, you know, like with the FSBO, right? It's different if you talk to a FSBO in the first week than if you talk to them, you know, 3 months in and their property still hasn't sold, right? The first week, what do they have? They still got their ego, right? I can do this myself. You know, I've sold another house before. This market's great, right? I'm going to save the commission, right? But 3 months in one of the best markets we've ever seen, their property still hasn't sold. How do you think they're feeling then?
Yeah.
Right. And so knowing, you know, that's the importance of when you're making that phone call is always getting into the mindset and getting into empathy with your consumer, right? With your seller. And because it's going to direct the way you talk to them. And it's super important that you're not just going through call after call saying the same thing robotically. You're not getting into empathy. You're not identifying with your customer, and you're probably not setting a lot of appointments because of that.
Exactly. Yeah.
So you know, like with FSBOs, obviously it's we know that the nurture cycle with FSBOs is a little bit longer, right? We know that with expireds, typically they've already identified two really important things. Number one, they want to sell their house, and more importantly, that they're willing to hire a realtor to help them, right? So we love making those calls, especially the new expireds.
Yeah.
And then with FSBOs, you know, if we're calling them, we're really just trying to deliver value, right? It's an introduction. It's maybe trying to get an appointment to go preview the home, and really just adding value, as much value, so that when they get to a point to where they're so frustrated because, you know, they've had a lot of people come through and kick the tires, unqualified buyers, nosy neighbors, that they think of you because you've delivered so much value, right?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. And so like with, do you guys do anything with internet leads?
Yeah, we do. Yeah, of course.
What kind of internet lead program do you guys have in place? Are you guys doing like Zillow or Boomtown or KB Core or anything like that?
I'm actually delving more into the KB Core since I came on with the EXP, and I love it. It's actually great. Doing a lot of the property boost is actually working really well.
Okay.
But a little bit of everything. I know they use Conversion Monster too. A lot of leads are coming in through there.
Yeah.
But once again, you got to know the numbers on that. You got to know the return rate on internet leads. And you know, what does your strategy look like for internet leads besides calling them? Because that's one thing. I notice people don't call the leads. They just email them.
Yeah.
And they get back.
You know, I think we know that the conversion rates on internet leads are obviously a little bit lower. However, I think that for our team is actually starting to grow. We're starting to actually do a little bit more business from our internet leads. And I don't know if it's because maybe people are not as focused on internet leads as maybe they once were.
Yeah.
But, you know, I love internet leads. I think that, you know, I think that if you follow up, if you build reports, just like anything else, that you can convert those leads. I think that the great thing about, you said you were having some success with your SOI. The great thing about your SOI is those are people who already know, like, and trust you, right? And so, and the hardest thing to do is to build rapport with somebody over the phone who you've never met, who's never seen you. And so you don't have to do that with your SOI. So like if you're going to call in to your SOI, certainly that's a little bit easier because you've already developed those relationships. Although there are some of us, myself included, who took the whole mindset of, well, you know, I don't want to bother my SOI. People that know me, people who already know, like, and trust me, I'd rather put myself through the hell of, you know, calling, you know, 100 random internet leads and trying to build rapport with people who don't even know me, right?
Dude, we all do it.
We're putting ourselves through our own personal hells, but you know, whatever. But you know, with the internet leads, it's like we're generating anywhere from probably 700 to, you know, 775 internet leads per month. You know, our goal is to get to the lead within the first, you know, 1 to 2 minutes if at all possible. Mm-hmm. We're trying to connect with the lead, obviously. We're trying to build rapport. I don't know about you, but I think what's changed with internet leads is the fact that there's just so much more data available now that we're really taking more of a concierge type approach. Since there's so much data, Stephen, we're really, our focus is on just trying to help the consumer decipher or disseminate the data that they're getting, and then making sure that we're delivering value either through their property alerts or through education, right? I know you said you were having some really good luck with video, and I know a lot of people are scared to do video, but video is super powerful. And if you're not doing video, you're probably getting close, or will be getting close to becoming irrelevant. But I looked over your vlog, man. I love it. It's very educational. It's very consumer driven. I mean, it's stuff that people want to consume. And so, like, when you're talking about internet leads, if you can, like, are you positioning those videos in front of your internet leads?
Somewhat. And I guess the caution too, like, while we're on the topic of video, is I feel like video is supplemental to your business. I mean, at least for me personally, it's not my main source of business, but like, I look at it this way, it's a touch. And you know, you want to touch, I touch my COI once a month via video. So I do that via my vlog, goes out via viral market. I don't know if you ever use that, but
yeah.
I do a video every month. I spend a lot of time on those videos. And my return is fairly decent on it, but it keeps me somewhat top of mind. It's a touch. So what I do with KV Core is I have a video that goes out via Zapier. I don't know how to pronounce it, but as soon as a lead comes in, an introductory video goes out from me. So that's the first time that they get a video from me.
What are you saying on that video?
It's similar to what I say over the phone to them. It's like, hey, it's Steve with eXp Realty. I saw that you checked out my website. So I just wanted to thank you for stopping by. And really quick, this will take less than 1 minute. I'll show you some of the free tools available to you, so you understand the functionality of the website.
Love it, man. So are you actually doing a video tutorial of how to go through the website?
Yeah.
Dude, that's brilliant, man. I love it. Yeah. Because that, you know, when we make the initial phone call, that, you know, that's one of the things we're saying. It's not so much about, I mean, obviously if they have a property they want to see, you're going to try and set the appointment. But we know a lot of those buyer leads, those internet leads, you know, they're just starting their search out. They're not as far down the buying or selling cycle as, you know, as someone who comes in and says, I'd like to go see, you know, 123 Main Street, right? So what you're doing is you're saying, okay, I understand that, right? And so where can I deliver value? I can deliver value by helping them utilize the site more efficiently. I can add value by, you know, educating them on how to win a multiple offer situation. Like I love talking to my agents about, you know, about how to win in a multiple offer situation by creating, like, we can do an escalation clause in our market, right? Where we say our offer will supersede any other written acceptable offer by $1,500 up to X amount, right? Yeah. I love getting in there, but a lot of people, like, we know that as realtors, but they're not using that on a larger scale level to help educate their buyers. And so right now, when you talk about video, and I know you said video is kind of like the supercharger on a Corvette, right? It's like Corvette's already fast, right? Corvette's already a nice car. It's fast. But when you add the supercharger, you know, then it becomes the Z06, and then you're 0 to 60 in 2.95 seconds, right?
You still got to know how to shift, though, you know? So that's what I mean. It's like supplemental.
Yeah, so exactly.
It's make you faster, but you got to know how to drive.
You got to know how to drive, man. I love it. And so, you know, but so like the video piece is huge, man. I think you're right. It's supplemental. It's adding, it's like the cherry on top. But so the internet leads, I mean, just to digress a little bit, the internet leads for us, definitely we're making sure that we're making contact quickly. We're following up. We do the 3-3-3. It's, you know, three times a day for the first 3 days, 3 times a week for the first 3 weeks, and 3 times a month for the first 3 months after that.
Yep.
And, you know, then we'll put them back in the gold mine if we haven't made contact with them. We have all of our agents that have access to the gold mine. So if they want to get in there and get leads, certainly they can do that. We have our gold mine set up so that our most vigilant agents win. And what I mean by that is a lead will sit in somebody's dashboard for 5 minutes. And if there's been no contact made, then it automatically is dumped into the gold mine, and those agents who are really vigilant can attack that lead.
Bullpen style. So the so let me ask you too, with you guys and your process and your goal there, are you trying to, is the end goal trying to keep them on your website, or are you open about, like, you know, Zillow is a great tool, use that? Or, you know, I see people trying to pull folks away from Zillow, even though they like to use it. So just a question. I mean,
we like to keep them on our site because of that big brother functionality. I mean, we can see what they're looking at, how many times they're looking at it. We can keep them more engaged, I think. So the more data we have on that consumer, the more we know the motivation, I think. So I guess the answer, short answer to your question is yes, we definitely want to keep them on the site if we can.
Yep. Okay. All right, cool. Yeah, I see some resistance to it every once in a while. So, like, I try to be diligent of the fact that, like, some people, you're not going to pull them off of what they're comfortable with.
Yeah.
So that's why you keep up bringing up value. And that's the point, man. It's like, have something on your site that's valuable to them that they can't get on the other sites.
You know?
And make sure you're pointing it out to them.
Yep. So I'm curious, man, what piece of technology, what's your favorite piece of technology right now that you're using, your app or your website or anything that's like your number one right now, your go-to?
I saw you posted that. I think that was yesterday or the day before.
Yeah.
I put YouTube on there, but really, BombBomb.
Okay.
Yeah.
And tell people what that is if they don't know.
BombBomb is a video platform that you can send email videos. It embeds the video into the email, and it has, you can set it up as like a GIF, so it can show you, like, actively, you know, moving around. The one that works pretty well, let me show you what I just did. Just did sent one to Eileen.
Yeah.
So I took a little thumbnail with, hi Eileen, so she knows it's specifically for her. And then as soon as she clicks on the video, it goes into what the topic was all about. So I'm using that for agent attraction. I'm also using that for people that were on my website. I'm using it for follow-up to open houses. And I'll tell you, I've made some good money with it. It's worked pretty well.
Love it. I love it. I love it. So BombBomb, man. So tell, I mean, you said you were using it for agent attraction. I think that's a great segue into your EXP. We got about 5 minutes left here. So tell me your EXP story, man. Like, how did you, I mean, I know Dave obviously came over in a huge wave, and you know, I had Dave over right when they made the move, but like, I want to know your personal story. I want to know what it meant to you.
You know, interestingly enough, at the beginning, I was a little hesitant because we were rolling at KW, you know, like, we were ranked like number 7 in the country. You know, I just had a kid. I was just kind of like, dude, let me play it safe, you know?
Yeah.
But then once I started really digging into the rev share was put in front of me, and obviously, like, being an agent in the market for a while, I'm like, you know, that could be attractive. But once I started digging into the tools that are available with EXP, I started getting really on board with it. And now I'm gung ho, man. It's because I'm using the KV core. We're using the Sky Slope and everything in the background. The functionality is fantastic. So, you know, now I'm all about it, and I'm bringing people into. So to go back to, like, how I'm using BombBomb. So, like, there's specific areas in which I don't service, right? So, like, I sell Hudson County, but I have a lot of investors that want to buy in Paterson, New Jersey. I don't know if you know about Paterson, but I don't really go there. So. But I could use a partner out there. So I'll go on Zillow. I'll look up people that are selling homes in Paterson, and I'll make a BombBomb video that starts with, like, my face down in the corner, like right down here. Yeah. And it's on their Zillow page. And it's like me saying, like, hey, looks like you're crushing it out in Paterson. I have too many referrals for Paterson, and it'll go back to me. And I'll just be like, listen, I'd like to at least take a moment to chat with you. I don't want all the business that's trying to move out that way. So I'm looking for a strategic partnership, and that's it.
Boom, man. That is gold nugget right there, baby. I love it. I love it. I love it, man. So I'm just curious, man, if people want to connect to you to learn more about your business or how you approach the phones, how you're crushing it, or maybe they just want to learn more about your move to EXP or have questions about EXP, how do they get in touch with you?
So there's multiple ways. So my website, which is the KB Core one, is rosadorealtor.com. And then my blog is Rosado Blog. So those both link to each other. All my contact information is up there, but I'm very open with everybody. My cell phone is open. Call, text, or email me. And I'm like you, man. At this stage of my career, I want to help as many agents as I can. That's why I love EXP, the way that it's set up. I'm really here to contribute to people that want to succeed.
Love it, love it. I love it, man. Prospecting is always one of my favorite topics. I mean, I built my business grinding on the phones. And I just love sharing these stories week after week because I know EXP is literally changing agents' financial lives, my own included. Hey, do me a big favor. If you know someone that might enjoy this podcast, please share it with them. If you like the podcast, please go to wherever you listen to podcasts and subscribe. If you want to learn more about why EXP is the fastest growing real estate company in the country, or you're interested in growing your business, head on over to explodingwealth.com. If you want to learn more about my business and why I moved to EXP, please go to meetmikewall.com and schedule a 30-minute one-on-one with me. And that is it for this one, folks. Steven, thank you so much.
Thank you, man. Appreciate you having me on.
All right, brother.